Turn the lights back on.
Wow. Retro electro tech.
When real audio ruled the world.
Greetings once again, all you audio hound dogs and pretty kitties, especially for those of you who dig vinyl and all things vinyl, turntables and all that. What we have here is, oh, and by the way, this is Retro Ernest of Retro Electro Tech. So what we have here is a Sherwood ST as in Sierra Tango, 802FG as in Fox Gulf turntable. And this came to me for some basic servicing, just some basic maintenance and setup. It had been stored away for quite some time along with the customer's other equipment. So he's resurrecting, you know, his old audio gear. And a matter of fact, it's the customer who brought in that Kenwood 9G receiver that I worked on recently. So yeah, we got this here to just go over and do some basic maintenance, which for the most part I already did as far as just the cleanup part of it and the re-lubrication. Very little to do in the way of lubrication. I didn't have to get into the tone arm or anything because that was okay. The tone arm swings freely. The bearings in the tone arm are as smooth as silk. But I went, you know, underneath and, you know, on the top side here and just re-lubricated the mechanisms that needed it where needed. So, and the motor as well, just a little drop or two of some sewing machine type oil, very light and something that doesn't over time gum up and get sticky. You'll see the unit in just a little bit with a platter back on, and I'm going to go into some basic setup, setting the tracking force and all that, and then just do a quick audio test. So on the main cam gear teeth here and the platter gear, in this case I used something. It's a Dow Corning product, a Molly coat. It's a EM30L, and it's pretty much made for this application. And yeah, it's kind of hard to see because it kind of has sort of a cool whip, kind of a creamier composition to it. You know, it's a lighter weight grease. As a matter of fact, I'll put a little bit on my finger. I really don't care. You know, I'm not worried about it. I'm not all paranoid about it. But anyways, but you can see probably how light it is, okay? And that's a nice consistency for this type of an application. So that's kind of the best way that I can describe it. Hopefully that's fairly clear. But anyways, because once again, we're not trying to bog down the mechanism and put a big slab of thick grease in there and all that. So that's that. And it's good, high quality stuff. It's really good with plastics, you know, a multitude of plastics. So that's what I've done there. I've just lightly brushed on the gear teeth here. This and it's a synthetic polyolefin grease. You can do the research, look it up, and see if it's right for you. So let's go ahead and flip her over. Okay, and here's the underside. We have our control board over there, and we have a power supply board over yonder. We have our sub plate here. So very, very basic. I'm going to go ahead and zoom into the plate and talk a little bit about that and what was done. Nothing groundbreaking on this turntable, and that's actually a good thing in that I personally like a simple turntable. This is manual set down, auto return, which is of course why the mechanism exists in this turntable. It's for auto return purposes, and So I removed the plate here and gained access, kind of looked around in there, checked things out. Everything's looking good. Cleaned everything out because there was some crust in here and dust and all that. So I got everything clear. I applied that polyolefin grease that I was just talking about, that EM30L, to the tracks or grooves under that main cam gear. And this slide here, okay, it's got three ball bearings in between this plastic plate and the slide, the actuator slide here. There's three ball bearings. You know, there's one in this corner, one over here. So there's no need to bog it down with any lubricant. You can probably hear the ball bearings. Okay, so it slides nicely. So you just kind of leave that alone. Otherwise, that's about it. I cleaned it all up, like I said, checked what little of the electronics there are, checked those out. Everything was looking good. I just did quick spot checking of the components, and everything's looking good there. And these levers, I did a little bit of re-lubrication of the levers here. And also too, and you probably can't really see it real well, but you'll get the point. This, because it's hard for me to kind of hover over, but this plate you see here on the underside, it's just a plate, a bracket that holds two potentiometers for the 45 and 33 RPM speed control. So I just pulled that out. It's just these four screws that lifted out, and then there was access to the potentiometers and the ports on the potentiometers. So I flush cleaned those and re-lubricated those, and they're working like an absolute charm, okay? So there you go. So everything is all nice and clean and inspected and all that. So, oh, and I, over here, there's a height adjustment for the cueing lever. The cueing lever was way too high, so I adjusted it and set the cueing lever height and all that stuff. Just kind of adjusted it. And then over here, I believe there's another screw for the set down adjustment and all that. Set down and all that is fine, so I didn't have to tweak around with that. And other than that, yeah, that's about it for this. So let me flip it back over, and we'll go from there. Alrighty, as you can see, we got the platter back on. I have it leveled off. So I'm going to talk about a few things here in one pop before I get into setting the tracking force and so forth. As you can see, I just use a torpedo level. Yes, there are the... let me see here. Yeah, there's the little platter levels, the bubble levels that you can, you know, set on your platter and all that. I very rarely even use these. I have them, a few different ones, but I always revert back to my torpedo level. I've always just liked to do it that way, and you can see if I just zoom in, it's leveled pretty nicely. You could probably see the bubble right there. And it's the same thing when I check the other axis here. Same thing, it's leveled off on that side too. You're just gonna have to take my word for it because I'm not gonna swing the camera around and all that. So okay, we have a nice level turntable that we're starting out with. Level enough. Again, it's not rocket science. And then let me go ahead and kind of change positions a little bit, and I'll show you what's involved in just balancing the tone arm. It's very, very simple. So really all you're doing is just adjusting that weight that you're looking at. Let me mess around with this light here, okay? So this weight here at the rear of your tone arm, you're just adjusting it, not not this dial initially. The dial that has the, you know, 0 and 0.5, 1 and 1.5, and all that, your grams scale, you're not going to mess with that right now. The only thing you're concerned about is initially turning the weight on the back until you float the tone arm. And you can see, if I back up here just a hair. Okay. You can see that I just have that tone arm floating, okay? And that's it. You can see it just floating there, and it's kind of settling a little bit. So you just want to adjust that weight on the back until you float that tone arm so that it is parallel with the deck of your turntable, okay? You want it even with the deck of your turntable, in other words. And I don't know, it's probably hard to tell at that angle because I really don't want to drop the camera down, but if I was to drop the camera down at the same level, you would see that the tone arm is parallel, level, with the deck of the turntable. So that's what we want. So that's when you, once you get it there, that's when you turn just the numeric dial there, the grams scale or dial, to 0. That's your 0 position when your arm is floating in free space, level with the deck of your turntable. That's 0. Okay. So that little dial there, that moves independently of the weight itself, okay? But when you turn the weight to adjust your tracking force, that little dial there will turn with the weight to indicate how many grams you're setting. Now, is it going to be spot on accurate when you compare it with the scale? Sometimes, you know, it's pretty darn close, but we'll see on this particular unit if that's the case. So let's go ahead and actually do that. Okay, so what are we going to do now that we have our tone arm zeroed out, the weight on the back there set to 0, as I already pointed out? Well, what we're going to do is something called measuring the tracking force, okay? And the tracking force is just the downward force that's exerted by the tone arm slash cartridge and stylus into the groove of your vinyl, okay? And that has to be set according to the specification of the cartridge in grams. And this cartridge is a Audio Technica AT71E as an echo that indicates a 1.5 to 2 gram tracking force. So we're going to measure that with a scale, just like you would measure the, you know, any type of weight, you know, on a scale, including yourselves, you know, when you jump on a scale. So we're going to do that, and we have a digital scale there. I also have an analog one, and they both work well enough to get you where you need to be. Sometimes, you know, the analog one isn't going to be as precise as the digital one, but even the analog one gets you close enough to where, you know, you're going to be right in that ballpark where it's not going to matter, okay? There's not going to be any big penalty in performance or tracking weight difference between the two, really. This one will be a little more precise, but either way. So, anywho, and one thing that I don't think I mentioned was when you're setting your tone arm to free float, when you're zeroing it out, you got to be careful. Make sure, because you know you have your cartridge and stylus in place, you got to make sure that you don't slam it down on the deck or the platter and damage your stylus, all that. So anyways, just be sure you have your hand underneath or some soft material or whatever the case down underneath it, just in case it slams down. But you should support it while you're doing that zero adjustment anyways. Not a big deal. I just thought I'd mention that. And yeah, anyways, So it's all set, ready to go. What I'm going to do now is rotate, because I have the tone arm locked in place. It's not actually free floating at the moment, even though it is zeroed out. I don't want it swinging all over the place, but it's sitting in its rest right now. And all I'm going to do, remember, I'm just going to start by setting the tracking force to the bottom end of the indicated range, which is 1.5. So I'm going to turn that. I'm going to turn the entire weight, not the dial. You only turn the dial when you're after you have the tone arm floating, like I said, and it's obviously zero, just floating. Then you turn just the little dial itself and get that zero right over the line there, and it's officially zeroed out. Okay, but I'm going to turn the entire weight now, and that little dial is going to rotate with the weight, and we're going to set it on 1.5, okay, because that's the bottom of the indicated adjustment there. So let me get in here and rotate this so that 1.5 is indicated there. Okay. And that's close enough. Different turntables, makes and models and all that will vary as far as how precise the weight is and how well calibrated it is. So we're going to check it right now, obviously. So I'm going to back off and, as indicated, let me go ahead and level this off just a bit. As indicated, we're going to check it on the scale there. And now when I release the tone arm from its rest, it should have that 1.5 grams of downward force or weight to it. And we're going to measure that on the scale here. So I'm going to reposition the camera so we're a little bit better position. Also, too, you want to make sure that the tone arm is not going to start spinning when you're trying to adjust things. I have a little piece of scotch tape here on the platter, and just tape to the front here. Normally I don't like to use scotch tape. It's not too bad. I don't have it pressed on too hard. It's better to use like that blue painter's tape, or what I like to use, and I don't know how many other people use this, but I started doing it myself, so I don't know if anybody else knows about that white poster putty, because it doesn't stain stuff, it doesn't get all sticky and gooey, and where you have to sit there and clean it off of the plinth or the deck or the platter. But I just get a little piece of poster putty, and I'm out of both. I'm out of the tape and I'm out of poster putty. I don't use colored putty, just the white stuff. And I stick it just between the platter and the plinth there, just kind of stick it in there lightly, just enough just to hold it, just to hold the platter from spinning, that's all. And then after that, I just grab it and pull it off, and it doesn't leave any residue, staining, or whatever. I just thought I'd mention that, but anyways, I just have scotch tape for now, good enough. So let me reposition things, and then I'm going to swing the tone arm over, and of course I'm going to have the cueing lever raised, and I'm going to swing it over and then bring it down right on that black dot. You see a black dot there on the on that target area of the scale? That's where we want to set our stylus down, right on that black dot. So let me go ahead and do that, and I'll get it positioned first, and then I'll turn the camera back on and set it down and all that, okay? Okay, so before I swing the tone arm over and use a cueing lever to drop the stylus down on that black dot, let me turn the scale on, and there's a 5 gram calibration weight here that I will set down right over the black dot, if I'm not too shaky. Oops, let me redo that. Okay, as you can see, we are right at 5 grams. We're looking good. It's in calibration. Let me go ahead and remove this. All right. And then I'm going to swing the tone arm over that black dot. I think I'm pretty darn close. Yeah, close enough. And let's see how close we are. Actually, when I set that weight, I didn't get it right over that line, 1.5 grams. Let me do that right now before I drop the tone arm down. Okay. All right. Let me make sure that stylus is over the black dot. Okay. Let me lower it down. Let me step back over to the camera to see what you see. 1.46. So I would say that's just about spot on, or 4.7. So yeah, that's pretty good. I mean, considering that I just used that little analog dial there on the tone arm weight, that's looking really, really good. So I can definitely live with that. But like I said, though, I do want to set it at about, or maybe I didn't say, I'm going to set it at about 1.7 grams, kind of a happy medium-ish. So 1.5 to 2 grams is what Audio Technica, the manufacturer, calls for that cartridge. So I'll just do 1.7, call it good. If the customer wants to adjust it and season to taste from there, he can, but that's more than fine. Now, just for kicks, let me bring in the analog before I move it from 1.5 to about 1.7. Let me bring in the analog scale and get that set up, and then I'll do the same thing, drop the tone arm down on it, and we'll sort of compare. Okay, so I set down the tone arm on the scale there, and I manually have to set the weight with this dial. Okay, so I set 1.5, and you can see the red arrow pretty much lines up spot on with this indicator here, okay? And I mean, it's just like barely a hair under if you were looking straight down on it, but I mean, but then again, we were also measuring what, 1.46, 4.7 grams. So, you know, if we want to split hairs, but this scale has always been very accurate and, excuse me, good enough to get you in the ballpark. And what I mean by ballpark is a very, very close ballpark. So yeah, this thing is a great scale. I use it interchangeably with the digital one. Just depends on which one I grab. You know, I have them around the shop here and there, but yeah, no problem. So there you go. I just wanted to show you analog versus digital, and yeah, it holds up well. Okay, and as I said, I was going to set it to 1.7 grams. You can see we have 1.71, close enough. So, looking good. Let's go ahead and move on to the next phase. Okay, so the next thing I'm going to set is something called Zenith. And think of it in terms of, you know, there's that expression, it's all about the angle of the dangle, right? So, and it is. It's about the angle of the stylus. Let me explain it this way. Okay, say that my fingers there, I'm making a V shape or peace, my brother. So say the peace sign there is the groove. Okay, this is the groove of the vinyl here. Yaw angle is this. Okay, you don't want the stylus taking on this angle. You want it nice and straight in that groove there, okay? So on this particular tone arm here, there's only so much adjustability, okay? I can adjust that zenith, that yaw angle that I'm talking about, by loosening these screws just slightly and literally twisting the body of the cartridge to get it to line up at the angle that I sort of described so that it rides in the groove the way that it should, at least in regard to yaw angle. And I'm going to do that by using this protractor. You can see there's lines that are drawn along this protractor that will help me to line up that angle correctly. Now there are other angles. There's also, and let me back off just a little bit, zoom out. So there's also the azimuth. And azimuth has to do with, if you're looking at the front of the cartridge, it's this way, like so, okay? Or, you know, just like this, or what's referred to as roll angle, you know, rolling from one side, rolling to the other. And yaw was like this, okay? Remember yaw, roll angle. And then there's one other adjustment too that could be made, and it's referred to as the vertical tracking angle or stylus rake angle, and that would be the pitch. So, you know, pitch like this, this way or this way. Now this tone arm here doesn't have the adjustment that I'm about to refer to, but some tone arms will allow you to raise the tone arm, you know, kind of raise the rear of the tone arm to get a different rake angle, all right? And this doesn't have that ability. If I had to perform some of those adjustments on this tone arm here, which I really wouldn't want to do because the amount of time and all that stuff, I'm just doing a basic setup here. So that's why I'm just doing the zenith and, you know, the tracking force, good enough. But another way that I could position that cartridge to adjust for that azimuth or roll angle would be to use shims, okay? Little plastic shims, and kind of give it a tilt that way. And, you know, same thing with rake angle. There's, you know, there's shims that you can utilize for that purpose too. You know, so there's the yaw, and then there's the roll, and then there's pitch, okay? So what I'm going to do here with this protractor is same thing. There's a little dot, and I don't know if you can see it if I zoom in, because I only have so much zoom before things get blurry, as you can see there. So let me just scoot this out of the way. And you could probably see that little dot. As a matter of fact, let me just point it out. So there's that little dot there. And that's where I want to set the stylus down, okay? So I'm going to bring it on over and then set down the stylus. And yeah, that looks like it's, yeah, that's right on the money. And if I look straight down, I have to look straight down over the face of the cartridge. And it's not running perfectly parallel with the line closest to it, okay? So the way I'm going to compensate for that is loosen these screws just slightly. As a matter of fact, I did actually do that a while ago. I forgot about that. Let me raise this slightly, and then I'm going to just give it a little... Yeah, right there. And then let me carefully set it back down right on that dot and measure again. Okay. Getting there almost. Give it another little That's probably looking pretty good. Let me just okay. I'll probably end up editing some of this here so that that looks good, actually. Let me see. Yeah, we're just about right on now. So if you were looking down over the face of this cartridge, it's now running parallel. Okay, so we're right on. And now what I need to do is make sure that it coincides with the other dot over here. Let me get it all lined up. And sometimes you just got to go back and forth and slightly tweak just a little bit. All right. But for the most part, yeah, we're just about right on. Let me give this another little, just a hair. Find that happy medium there. And you just got to get it as close to perfect as possible between those two, what they refer to as null points. Okay, and that's all we're doing. We're just trying to find the happy medium between the two null points and get that face as straight on parallel to those lines as possible. And so far, so good. All right, let me... get it. Yeah, that's looking pretty nice right there. Okay, so now I'm just going to very carefully just tighten those screws down. And then you know what? We're in business. I'm going to go ahead and do that and then do an audio test. And this thing will be good to go. And like I said, if I was going to get into things deeper and all that, well, at least with this turntable, with this tone arm, I would have to, shim the cartridge. And I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to shim the cartridge. We're just going to have to go with factory on that. And the fact that I have looked at this stylus under some basic magnification, and the cantilever and all that looks pretty straight. It doesn't look tweaked or bent. It looks right on, at least by eye. Okay, so that's going to be good enough for this one. So anyways, guys, let me go ahead and do what I need to do here, tighten those screws, and then I'll be back. Oh, and by the way, one thing I did want to mention that I didn't mention earlier is that I had to change a belt on this as well, because the belt was really deteriorated. I had to get a razor and scrape it off of the platter there, and then this platter mat, if you want to call it a platter mat, it's just this hard plastic. When I lifted it off, you could see it cracked and everything. It's so brittle, really brittle. Just lifting it off, it cracked, and there was an oily substance underneath, and yeah, really a mess. So I got a nice rubber platter mat on there, as you can see. So the service on this is looking good. Let's go ahead and get her all hooked up, and we'll do an audio test. Okay, so since this video is already pretty long, is this going to be a short little function test of this turntable? I already tried the 45 end of things. 45 is playing at speed, it's doing good. I'm just going to drop the needle on this piece of vinyl here, and I'm going to get a little copyright thing, a little slap on the wrist or whatever they're going to do. That's just the way it is testing vinyl, at least on video. I can't do YouTube safe music for this, so I don't make any claims to have any rights or to own this music. This is strictly for testing purposes, and that's really all I can say about that. So I'll let it play for just a little bit, and then we'll end it. Okay, so this cueing lever likes to drop down kind of quick, so I gotta be careful here. Okay, so that's looking good. And also too, let me just actually kind of walk it over so you can see that the end of play is working just fine. And it'll set down and shut off. Okay, so there it is. Working like it should. So I'm going to end it here, guys. And as I always say, peace, love, music, and the vintage audio that brings it to your ears. Till next time, y'all take care.
This is a Poor Man's Shoe production.